Well, let's take our bulletins and turn to Psalm 92. You'll find the scripture reading there. Psalm 92. Let's hear the word of God. It is good for us to give thanks to the Lord, to sing your praises to your name, O Most High, to declare your steadfast love in the morning and your faithfulness by night, to the music of the lute and the harp, to the melody of the lyre. For you, O Lord, have made me glad by your work. At the works of your hands I sing for joy. How great are your works, O Lord! How your thoughts are very deep. The stupid man cannot know, the fool cannot understand this. Though the wicked sprout like grass and all evildoers flourish, they are doomed to destruction forever. But you, O Lord, are on high forever. For behold your enemies, O Lord, for behold your enemies shall perish, all evildoers shall be scattered. But you have exalted my horn like that of the wild ox, you have poured over me fresh oil. My eyes have seen the downfall of my enemies, my ears have heard the doom of my evil assailants. The righteous flourish like the palm tree and grow like a cedar in Lebanon. They are planted in the house of the Lord. They flourish in the courts of our God. They still bear fruit in old age. They are ever full of sap and green to declare that the Lord is upright. He is my rock, and there is no unrighteousness in him. I wonder if you've ever felt like Frodo in J.R.R. Tolkien's Lord of the Rings. I wish, said Frodo, I wish it need not have happened in my time. You can add in what you particularly might have in mind. So do I, said Gandalf, and so do all who live to see such times. But that is not for them to decide. All we have to decide is what to do with the time that is given us. I wish it had not happened in my time. So many things have been happening in our world in the last 4 or 5 months, haven't they, that we feel like that. And if you're keeping up to date, if you're watching the television news, I hope you're not overdosing on the news because you'll need a lot of therapy afterwards. But I imagine you're aware of the fact that most people today appear to be angry or bitter. They seem to be angry at everyone and bitter about everything. Angry and bitter people are not happy people. So, what is the lesson? The lesson is, if you're angry and bitter, here are the best words of psychology and counseling that I can offer you. Stop it. That's all. Just stop it. Angry and bitter people are not happy people. You don't want to be bitter and angry, do you? You want to be happy. And there's something better than anger and bitterness. And this song for the Sabbath, which is the title of Psalm 92, sounds a very different note. And the clue is in those words. Look at this passage with me, because I want you to notice this. The clue is in these two words, glad and joy. Look at verse 4. For you, O Lord, have made me glad by your work. At the works of your hands, I sing for joy. This text, these words, have a different feel to what we see and hear on our news cycle today. They go against the grain of the feeling in our modern and contemporary society. The speaker, of course, is talking about the Sabbath, the Lord's Day. He's speaking about when God's people come together on the Lord's Day as the church. And he says about the church, it is good to give thanks to the Lord and to sing praises to your name, O Most High. He's saying to the church, instead of screaming out hate, instead of spitting out condemnation, instead of being preoccupied with your complaints and your moans and your groans, give thanks and praise God. Our thanks and our praise, you notice where they're to be directed. Our thanks and our praise are to be directed to the God who is there, to the Lord. All uppercase letters there in verse 4, which means we're talking about the one who says, my name is, I am, I exist, I just be. It refers to the God who exists, the God who is there. But he's also the God who is the Most High. That means that this God who's there, who merely exists and his existence is the essence of who he is, this God is a God that is beyond our grasp intellectually, even in our imagination, beyond our grasp. I don't have to use any big words here this morning, simply to say this, that this God is, there is more to God that we can think or say. Now that is not to say that we have nothing to think about or that we have nothing to say. It is this, however, that once we have thought all we can think about God, and once we've said all we have to say about God, there will always be more to say and to think. With what we know, we are able to say with all the force of our nature, that's the meaning of the word to declare there in verse 2, we're able to say with all the force of our nature, declaring that God is forever and always love, that God is forever and always faithful, that being loving and being faithful is who God is. And that immediately makes God safe to go to and safe to trust in, unlike other people. We are always safe to go to God and to trust in God. But what the writer is saying, what the psalmist is saying here, is that when we go to God and we trust in God and we declare what we believe about God, the forever and always loving one, the forever and always changeless one, this God makes us glad. He fills us with joy. Now, what is it about God then that makes us glad and fills us with joy? The answer is in verse 4. Our text talks about his work and his works. Those are two different words in the Hebrew. One is singular, one is plural. And the very use of these two words is telling us something about how God's own life works in himself and how God's own life looks like, what it looks like to those of us who are on the other side, looking on at him and watching him as he goes about his business. Well, what do we know about what God's own life looks like in himself? Well, we didn't know very much about what God's life looked like in himself until Jesus comes into the world and teaches us that God is three in one and one in three, which tells us that there's more to God than we might have thought. Even with all that we learn of him in the Old Testament, there's more to God. He is richer than we thought, deeper than we thought of him to be. And what Jesus taught us, by the way, is the hardest thing to get our heads around, among many hard things to get our heads around when it comes to thinking about God. So what does God's own life look like to God? Well, there's only one God. So therefore, only one way of looking. God is the source from which everything else that is comes into being. We learn this about God. We learn that God is full of life and love, and that life and love flow forth from the Father to the Son in the Spirit, and love and life flow from the Son and the Spirit back to the Father. One God within this dynamic life. One life, one love, one mind, one will, and then when he acts outside of himself, one work. One work. Think about the incarnation. Who did the incarnation? Who's responsible for the incarnation? Is it the baby? God manifest in the flesh. Is it the Holy Spirit who worked the miracle in the womb of Mary and the conception of Jesus? Is it the Holy Spirit? Is it God the Father who prepared the body? In fact, what we learn in the Old Testament is that the Father, Son, and the Spirit conspire together to prepare the genetic material of that body that Jesus would inhabit when he became flesh. Even the incarnation is one work. Though from our side, we divide up the parts. So what does the life, God's life, look like from our side? This is where we see the use of the second word, works. When I reflect on God, your work in yourself, one work of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and I look at what you have done from me, from my perspective, because I am a creature, and there are other creatures, and my perception of reality has to deal with all these other stimuli that are coming at me from all kinds of direction. From my perspective, I see what you do divided up into parts. The works of God are something we see when we think of the work of the three in one. God's work, in other words, his one work, is refracted through the lens, the human lens, and appears as the work by which he makes things, maintains things, and then makes things new. The technical word for those three things is creation, and providence, and redemption. Well, we're looking at providence today. God makes things. That's where we began last week. We took a time to look at the big picture. I think it was mind-numbingly and mind-stretchingly difficult for some people. Today, I want to come to the bit that I missed out at the end, because I'd gone long enough last week. And it's simply to say this. What is it that causes us to be glad and give thanks and to sing for joy at the work that God has done, especially the work of creation? I referred last time to Saint Augustine, the North African bishop of Hippo, the greatest theologian in the Christian church since Paul. And he said on one occasion to his congregation, some people, he said, in order to discover God, read books. But there is a great book, the very appearance of created things. Look above you, he said. Look below you. Heaven and earth shout to you, God made me. He expands on this thought in his book, The City of God. He teaches us how to give thanks and praise for the work of creation. St. Augustine again. Shall I speak of the manifold and various lovelinesses of the sky and earth and sea, of the plentiful supply and wonderful qualities of the light, of sun, moon, and stars, of the shade of trees, of the colors and perfume of flowers, of the multitude of birds, all differing in plumage and song, of the variety of animals, of which the smallest in size are often the most wonderful, the work of ants and bees, astonishing us more than the huge bodies of whales. Shall I speak of the sea, which itself is so grand a spectacle, when it arrays itself in various colors, now running through from every shade of green, becoming purple and blue? Isn't it delightful to look at the sea in a storm and experience that soothing reassurance that it inspires by suggesting, as you stand on land, observing the storm, that you are not being tossed around and shipwrecked in the storm you're watching? What shall I say, he says, of the numberless kinds of food to alleviate hunger and the variety of seasonings to stimulate appetite, which are scattered everywhere by nature and for which we are not indebted to the art of cookery? How many natural applications are there for preserving and restoring health. How grateful for the alternation of day and night. How pleasant the breezes that cool the air. How abundant the supply of clothing furnished by trees and animals. What he's saying is that nature itself offers us daily an infinite supply of reasons why we should give thanks and offer praise to God. God makes things. Secondly, then, God maintains things. This is what we call providence. What can we say, then, about God making things and maintaining things? Well, he is the source of all existence. And we can say, first of all, that he keeps existence existing. This is how the scripture puts it. It ties the existing nature of the world to the Son of God himself. And it says this in Colossians chapter 1. By him, that is the Son, all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. Jesus is the glue that holds the universe together. Actually, it's saying more than that. That's far too passive. He is the energy that is activating every neuron, every quark, the smallest detail, every atom of our universe, and keeping it together. In other words, Jesus is not only in redemption and in creation, but also in the maintaining of the world. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, not just for salvation, but for the existence, the continuing existence of the planet and the universe. And the Father is active here, the Holy Spirit is active, the Son is active, not only on history by deciding what happens, but acting in history by the Spirit and doing all things through the Son. The God of Scripture is actively engaged in making and maintaining all things. And we learn from Scripture that he has plans. He has plans for the world, plans for us as individuals, plans for his church. He forged those plans in eternity. These plans are executed in time. This is what it means, that a personal God is behind it all and over it all. Paul explains this in Acts chapter 17 when he's in Athens, and he quotes a pagan philosopher. In him we live and move and have our being, said the pagan. In other words, Paul is teaching us that even pagans know that God is not far away. In fact, quoting a pagan again, he himself gives life to all mankind, life and breath and everything. Hebrews chapter 1 says that Jesus is upholding all things by the power of his word. In other words, the word that expresses his will is what keeps the universe going. The one who through whom everything was made is now actively sustaining all things. Jesus reminded the disciples of this when he taught them that God the Father richly dresses the grass of the field, feeds the birds of the air. That God not only decrees what will come to pass, but he is active in the making and maintaining, in the directing and the guiding of all things to their ultimate end. In him we live and move and have our being. God is the source of the continuing existence of the world. And God is not only the source, but as the source is actively involved in our continuing existence. People talk about luck, but there is no such thing as luck. The Christian can say this: the Lord gave, the Lord has taken away, blessed be the name of the Lord. In other words, nothing has happened by chance. We can look at the events of the last few months and we can blame these people and other people for what's happened and so on. And we can come up with our explanations, and we're probably right in some of our theories and so forth and so on. But one of the things we must never allow ourselves to get into the way of thinking is this. We must not think for one nanosecond that anyone took the reins out of God's hands, or that anything that has happened has not been permitted by the will of God. There are no rogue molecules in the universe, as R.C. Sproul said. The Lord gave, the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. And it's our trust in the good will of God that enables the believer to be content, whether in wealth or poverty. God is generous, as much to unbelievers as to believers. The Lord is good to all, it says. His mercy is over all that he has made. Martin Luther used to talk about the milkmaid and the baker and say that they were masks God hides behind to answer our prayers for daily sustenance. God is invisible, but he uses creaturely instruments to make things that we buy and that we consume. He uses his own created laws. We talk about the laws of nature. You understand God is not tied in by the laws of nature. The laws of nature are our observation of the way God normally does things. We observe what normally happens. We make an assumption it will happen again tomorrow, and we build our lives on the flow of how God normally works. Miracles exert no more effort from God than the normal way he works. He may just in a moment choose to do it a different way. It doesn't take any more than a thought to do that for God. And the reason why God uses creaturely things is to protect us from the blinding majesty of his presence. The Heidelberg Catechism describes this beautifully. The almighty and ever-present power of God, by which he upholds, as with his hand, heaven and earth and all creatures, and so rules them that all things, in fact, come to us, not by chance, but by his fatherly hand. God doesn't have a hand. That's why the Catechism says, as with his hand. Well, we can imagine then the language put in our terms that we would understand. Everything comes to us by his fatherly hand. In other words, God's providence, his governance, everything that God has decreed for the universe, for after he made it, everything that exists and occurs in time is comprehended by God. It exists from him, through him, and to him. And he's always active. He is pure act, causing things to exist. The human soul, every human soul that is joined to a human body in the composite we call a human being, every human soul is the direct creation of God. Every form of life, the working every second to sustain it in existence. No substance, no power, no activity, no idea exists except from, through, and to God. And this includes his care not only for things in general, but for the hairs of your head. I guess he adds and subtracts them. He's subtracting mine at the moment, and I can't do anything about that. But he cares for the hairs of your head and the sparrows and the birds of the air and the lilies of the field and the young ravens. The smallest thing and the greatest thing, because things are neither great nor small to God, who is himself infinite. The same divine power that creates everything out of nothing, that same power is necessary to unfold the potential laid up in creation. And it continues the existence of creatures. They exist by his will and power alone. Okay, I said that God is the source of all things that exist. So he keeps all things in existence, and he's intimately involved in keeping all things in existence, and is he specially involved for the sake of his own people. That is, for the sake of the church. Now, I need to say something before we get into that. I need to say this, that he does not care exclusively for his own. People who do not know God, do not trust or love him, are nonetheless beneficiaries of God's kindness. I began to quote earlier, Psalm 145, "The Lord is good to all, his mercy is over all that he has made. The eyes of all look to you, and you give them their food in due season. You open your hand, you satisfy the desire of every living thing." Jesus said, "For God makes the sun to rise on the evil and the good. He sends the rain on the just and the unjust." My mother used to read that to me when we were growing up in Scotland. And she used to say, "There must be a lot of unjust people in Scotland because we get so much rain." We sometimes call this, in theological circles, we call this God's common grace. That God gives out gifts to everybody: physical life, health, intelligence, love, friendship, passion, vocation, family, culture, government, art, science, arts and science, to Christians and non-Christians alike. In his common grace, God puts us into societies. And he places in those societies powers that be to be ministers of God and to act on his behalf, to restrain, to put a restraint on human sin. Sin resides in every heart, every human heart. Therefore, sin resides in every human institution, in states, in governments, in all human institutions, corporations, and even churches. All human institutions are fallen institutions. But they are necessary because God put them there. Why has God put them there? They have a duty under God to preserve human society from descending into anarchy. There are examples in history. The French Revolution was a bloody, random affair. It led to indiscriminate bloodletting. It started killing one lot of people, and that then exponentially went out until there was virtually nobody that was safe from Madame Guillotine. The mob ruled. Similarly, it was in Nazi Germany after the end of the First World War, when Germany was badly dealt with at the end of that war. Large chunks of Germany were given to France and Poland, and famine reigned in Germany. There was no means of supply and so on. And into that vacuum comes Nazism, promising the world, of course. Hitler abolished the police force. His mobs of brown shirts would go around the community, and they would hunt out the people that were the undesirables. As one churchman once said, who lived in Germany during that period, "They came for the Jews, but I wasn't a Jew, and I said nothing. They came for the gypsies, but I wasn't a gypsy, so I said nothing. They came for the homosexuals, but I wasn't a homosexual, so I said nothing. Then they came for me, and there was no one else to speak." Mobs don't think. Mobs act blindly. Mobs are usually the gullible tool of evil people who foment the trouble and wind them up and let them go. And the man of lawlessness, Antichrist himself, and the spirit of Antichrist, the spirit of lawlessness that is in the world, is something that comes from hell because law and order are God's gifts to society to restrain human sin. Because we all need restraining. So even pagan rulers rule by God's providence as well. And it would be true to say that The sons of darkness are often wiser in their generation than the children of light are. Jesus said that. If you think back in the past, non-Christians rescued slaves, some non-Christians, while some Christians abused slaves. Because Christians are both justified and still sinful. Even a fallen world, in other words, can reflect something of God's wisdom and goodness, truth and justice, beauty and love. He does not care exclusively for his own, but he cares especially for his own. Especially for his own. Now, when I say God cares for you and me as his own, I don't just mean that he does that when things are going well for us. The believer lives in light of eternity. As Paul does in Romans chapter 8 when he says, the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed in us. The evil days will come. Ugly times may come. They may come at the will of evil people. People have free will. They act freely on their will. But we read in Scripture that God works all things together for our good. Even the evil days and the ugly times, he works all things together for our good, which means our ultimate salvation. In Psalm 73, the wicked are successful and influential. The psalmist says, I saw the prosperity of the wicked. I was envious of the arrogant when I saw their prosperity. I thought in my heart, all in vain have I kept my heart clean. Why? What am I doing here? Why am I putting myself through the anguish of following God and following God's ways and keeping my heart clean when people who just disregard every moral impediment in their way, disregard it all. They're prospering. They're doing well. They're raking it in. They're having a time of their lives. You ever been there? The psalmist got there. And he was weary of it all, he tells us, until I entered the sanctuary. And in the sanctuary, I remembered something that I'd forgotten. I remembered their latter end, he says. That is, I remembered their ultimate destiny and doom. The wicked are getting the best time and living their best life now because this is the only good life they will ever enjoy. We need to understand this, that these people who are wasting their substance and wasting their lives on simply pleasure and in getting power and having influence and all these things that they're using and abusing to their own advantage, that is all they've got and all they will ever have for all eternity. They are facing judgment, the wrath of God. The man in Psalm 72 realizes that, and God enables him to take the long view. He says, you guide me with your counsel, and afterwards you will receive me into glory. You see, there's another aspect to the doctrine of providence when we're thinking theologically, and you don't need to worry about this, but it's called concurrence, and that is that humans will what humans want, and humans do what humans will to do and what they want to do. That's a normal part of life. But of course, humans are limited in what they can will to do and want to do. They may want to do great things and not be able to. I want to fly like Superman when I was a little boy, and I never managed to do it. I did jump off some walls, but there was with a Superman cape on my back, homemade, but I didn't fly. Sorry to say, never flew. No Lois Lane either. So we can will to do things, we can want to do things, but we won't be able to do them because we are limited in our power. God, on the other hand, has power to do all that he wills to do. And in his willing, he can utilize, he does, not just can, he does regularly, utilize the freely used will of a human being, he uses that for his own purpose. You remember when Joseph was with his brothers, they came to see him, and Joseph reveals himself to them, and they're shock, horror, here he is, he's alive. And Joseph says to them, do you remember what he says to them, to his brothers, looking them in the eye after all of these years, since they had abandoned him in a hole in the ground and left him to die, and then saw the main chance when a caravan was coming through the area and they sold him off and made some money on him. He looks them in the eye and he says, you meant this for evil. You meant it for evil. This wasn't something you did on the spur of the moment. This wasn't somebody's bright idea and you all went along with it. You intentionally meant this for evil. You wanted me dead. You wanted me dead. But God meant it for good, that many people would be saved, including you and the family and back there in Israel, and my father, and you, my brothers. You didn't realize it. You wanted me dead. God wanted me alive in Egypt so that I could change the world. We started our worship today by reading Acts 2. Acts 2 says that the people who killed Jesus did what they wanted to do. You crucified and killed by the hands of lawless men. You crucified and killed. That's what you wanted, and that's what you did, by lawless men. And yet even in their decision, and even in the use of their will, what were they doing? They were serving the bigger purpose of God, because God uses these things to achieve his own purpose, so that human beings are left guilty before God for what they wanted, just as Joseph's brothers were, just as these people were, guilty of killing, crucifying the Christ. But he says, what you did was you did according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God. And God raised him up, loosing the pains of death, because it was not possible for him to be held by it. You can be sure that in the things that are happening in our world today, in our lives and in our world and in our society, there are evil people who, with their machinations, are plotting and planning and scheming evil things. Maybe they will come to do these evil things. But we are reminded again today that God himself uses evil to purify his church, to accomplish his will, and to bring salvation to the world. Let's not lose sight of that. We may not have wanted to have lived in these times, but in living in these times, as we find ourselves, let's do what we can do, and that is, let's trust in God and in the wisdom of his providence. Lord, guide us with your counsel, and afterwards, will you receive us into glory. In Jesus' strong name, amen.